Delivered.
Send deliverance.
Deliverance.
Send deliverance is good.
Deliverance is good.
Better out than in.
Better out than in.
He delivered me from all my fears. I sought the Lord. Matthew 6:33, the Lord. Amen. I Matthew 6:33, the Lord. I sought the Lord. I've been seeking the Lord. That 6:33 that I told you started in, when was it, December or November, whenever, I'm still seeing 6:33 and I'm still seeing 16:33 every day, twice a day, it's like clockwork. So still the Lord wants us to seek. But I believe this is what the Lord is saying to us. In our seeking, He's going to answer. And the first order of business in answering, He's going to deliver us. Say, I'm ready to be delivered. Say, deliverance is healthy.
Deliverance is healthy.
Deliverance is necessary. For healing and growth. Hallelujah. Amen. So this is my opening scripture, but this is also my waiver. The second part of this is also my waiver for the day, from where the Lord is going to take these points. Now, for those of you who had Nexus on Wednesday night, we spoke about the two trees. We spoke about the tree that is full of life and full of good things and is full of growth. And it is the tree that comes from the Spirit. It is the tree of love, right? You spoke about the tree of love. We spoke about the fact that when the Spirit is involved in your life and when the Holy Spirit is dominant in your life is going to produce. Amen. And then we said the opposite of that wasn't hate, but it was fear. Right? And then we had a tree of fear. And the tree of fear had all sorts of weird roots, all sorts of toxic roots. And the tree of fear produced nothing except depression, anxiety, stress, all sorts of problems, health problems, mental problems, emotional problems. Because the tree of fear has been totally removed from the Spirit, which is love. So Pastor actually said to me yesterday, I had a couple of things like I said I wanted to say. And she asked me, do I have a message? And I said, yeah, I think so. I'm just wrestling with the Lord a little bit. And she said, what about the continuation of Wednesday night? Because she felt that that was necessary. And in that moment, I didn't take it, but that was really the start of what the Lord was saying to me, that we need to continue a bit, discussing a bit about this tree of fear and what the cycle of fear does to us. Now, please know, it's not love and hate, it's love and fear. Because 1 John 4:18 tells us that perfect love drives out fear. It doesn't tell us perfect love drives out hate. Right? And remember I explained on Wednesday night that hate doesn't exist. Hate is a secondary emotion. Hate is secondary only to fear. Hate is secondary only to panic. It is secondary only to disappointment. It is secondary only to sadness. It is secondary only to those other things. Like I said, you don't just wake up one day and say, I hate you. Chances are a whole lot of other things leading up to you getting to that point. That is why hate doesn't exist on its own. Amen. Are we together, people? So hate is a secondary emotion. So opposite of love is fear. And that is why we looked at several scriptures, including 2 Timothy 1:7, where the Lord says, I have not given you a spirit of fear. I've not given you a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind. So, for example, if you find that you don't have a sound mind, chances are there's fear that is manifesting you. If you find that you do not have a self-discipline, somehow there is fear. You feel that you're going to miss out on something or you're going to lose something if you don't do what you're supposed to do or whatever the funny thing in your mind is. But it is clear that God has not given us a spirit of fear. And as such, that is why Psalm 34 said He delivered me. Because if fear is a spirit, we're going to be delivered from that spirit. Amen. Say it again. Deliverance is a good thing. Hallelujah. So God has not given us a spirit of fear. It is not in God. So if it is not in God, how can we normalize things that are linked to fear? How can we normalize anxiety? How can we normalize depression? How can we normalize poor health? How can we normalize toxicity in our thoughts? How can we normalize those things and then still say, no, we normalize the way of God? How can we normalize behavioral problems and say, no, it's things that I'll never forget. Never forget Evangelist John Kenneth Shuttlesworth. Loving with fear, him, I guess I should say, not loving with hating, right? Loving with fear, I love the way he moves in his anointing because he's unapologetic. You guys know what I'm talking about. Evangelist Jonathan Shuttlesworth. He's absolutely unapologetic in how he moves in the things of the Lord. He's very apostolic for an evangelist, but anyway. And one day he was at a meeting, and people came up and they brought a child up for prayer. And I think they said that this child has behavioral problems, and he has this disorder. And they listed like five symptoms that this child has been diagnosed with. And the child was on eight different forms of medication, and whatever. And the parents said something like, and we attend at this church, because obviously it was a crusade, right? So he was visiting at this place. And then the parents tried to buff him up, and they said, we attend at this church, and we believe that the Lord can heal, and please pray, please minister over our son. We hear you, support our son. And the evangelist looked at the parents. Can I get someone who's on a prayer with cold hands, please? Quickly. Thank you. And the evangelist looked at him, and he put two hands on the child's head, and he said, be normal! Amen. And the parents were highly offended. They're like, what is that? Didn't you hear? We attended this church. We put money in the offering and whatever, and they got two words, be normal. 4 days later, the child was performing better. 4 days later, the child started producing results of what would have been, I guess, a normal child, whatever the case is. But too often, we try to accept these things, and we want these things to be peppered. When I went to Soweto a few weeks ago, the people first looked at me with shock, and then they looked at me with disgust, and then they started laughing nervously. I'm not sure which order you're going to do it in today, but too many of us want to pepper our emotions. Not to pepper. We need to take the baby and we put the baby on the back. Oh, this anger. Oh, shoo. Do anger. Oh, jealousy. Do. And you pepper your emotions. No. Those things are not in the Lord. We shouldn't be rationalizing them. We shouldn't be normalizing them. We shouldn't be accepting them. Amen, people of God. And yet here we are. We're so afraid to be seen otherwise. We don't want people to see our shortcomings. So we'd rather put before this and this and this. I had a person walk away from our presence. Oh, no, I actually walked away from this person's presence many years ago. Now please hear me, because I know people can get sued for such statements. So hear me carefully. I'm not saying don't take your medication. I'm not saying don't go to therapists. I'm not saying that. I'm saying this is who I am. So please respect me for what I believe. Right, this is what I believe. So this person came and they went, oh no, they got this, and they got that, and they got this diagnosis, and that diagnosis, and that diagnosis. And I'm like, and I walked away. And the person was mad. And I never came back to this church, but that's fine. I'm not here to be bad. I have a job. Psychologists have a job. Let me do my job.
Yes.
Don't expect me to cross over into someone else's sphere of influence. My sphere of influence is talking about the things of the Lord. In the Lord, there is no fear. In the Lord, there is no recognition of such things. No normalization of such things. Hallelujah. So let me do my job. And let me say that there is no fear in love. Because perfect love drives out that fear. So point number one, I want you to team, I want you to write it down. I've got 7 points for you that I'm missing now. Probably not. I've got 7 points for you and we'll see what happens. The first point is, fear feeds imaginations. The what ifs. Some of us are so stressed about life. We're not even stressed about today. We're stressed about 5 years' time. Some of us are so full of fear about our situations. We actually have nothing to do with current, but we are so full. Our imaginations about the future has been fed by these fears. But what if this? What if that? What if this? What if that? What? That is not of the Lord. Because there are several accounts of where Jesus says, what good is it going to be for you to worry? By worrying, you will not add a single day to your life. And here we are riddled. Oh, I wonder if the petrol price is going to go up next month. Oh my gosh, I can't take another petrol price increase. Oh my gosh, I wonder if I'm in a good place for my child. Oh my gosh, I wonder how expensive the food is going to be at Christmas. And we are fearing things that may or may not materialize. Why? Because we've stepped out of peace. allowing that tree of love, governed by Holy Spirit, to grow, there will be no space for that. How can leaves and nothing grow on the same tree? Does it make sense? How can leaves and nothing grow on the same tree? It's either going to be leaves or it's going to be nothing. You can't have both. Amen. So fear feeds our imaginations. And when I say imaginations, I mean those that are mentioned in 2 Corinthians 10:5. Those that are mentioned in 2 Corinthians 10:4 even. 2 Corinthians 10:4. The weapons that we have are of divine nature to pull down imaginations. What if my partner's cheating on me? What if they're going to do that? What if they're going to leave me? What if? No, people, that is fear. We need to recognize it for what it is, and we need to say, I want to be done with this thing because it is not healthy for me. What if I never find my purpose? What if I never move in ministry? You know, I looked at Teacher Dave. Teacher Dave has been with Apostle Deb, I think it was for about 14 years. 14 years, 3 years ago, he became a deacon. He was there for 14 years, and 3 years ago, he became a deacon. Last year, the year before, he moved into his collect office, which is that of a teacher. He was there for over a decade without even blinking. Some of us come into the church 2 months, and we want to know what our purpose is. We can be said, what are we going to do? Blah, 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 blah. Hey, just pump the brakes. And don't allow fear to feed the imaginations of the unknown. Because if you're going to do that, I'll lead you out to my other points later. You're going to rob yourself of destiny. You're going to rob yourself of your purpose. If you're allowing the fear of whenever to feed the imaginations, you're going to rob yourself of peace in your home. You're going to rob yourself of strength. You're going to rob yourself of sleep, laying awake and thinking about what may or may not happen. Fear feeds imaginations. If you find yourself panicking about something that hasn't or may not ever happen, you've got fear in you. If you find yourself panicking and freaking out about the unknown, you've got fear in you. Amen?
Amen.
Number two. This one, the Lord gave me as a two-pronged, and I wasn't sure, but I'm just going to speak it out anyway. Number two, fear paralyzes the heart and blinds to the new. Fear paralyzes the heart and blinds to the new. Fear paralyzes the heart and blinds to the new. I'm going to take it backwards. Fear blinds you from the new. If you're so afraid of not getting, if you're afraid of missing out, if you're so afraid of whatever, whatever, the new is going to arrive and you're not going to see it. If you're so afraid of what happened in the past, the new thing in front of you is going to go boom in it. If you're so afraid of what may or may not manifest, you're going to miss out what the Lord is doing right now. If you're afraid of being uncomfortable, if you're afraid of being exposed, if you're afraid of being whatever, you are going to miss out on what the Lord is doing in this moment. Fear blinds a person to the new. I've seen this. It's happening too often in ministry, where it has been declared over individual, over ministry, over household, over what. The new of the Lord is here. Look for the new in this, look for the new in that. And then people are so afraid of what the new could be, because it is unknown. Amen? That they hold on so tight. And the new can just pass them by. I've heard recently that a couple of people have said, but we're supposed to be in a new era. We are in a new era. What are you looking for? You're looking for things of the old era. That's why you don't see it. You're missing out on the new things because you're looking for the old things. I can guarantee you, people of God, the things that I've seen in the Spirit, things I'm encountering in the Spirit, the advancement even in our prayer and in the direction that the Lord is leading us, we are in a new era. Apostle Chuck Pierce has declared his Rosh Hashanah message for this coming year, new era. It is still going on over 3 years. And remember, new era is not going to be like bam, new era. No, an era means it's a long period of time. The new era will take maybe when a baby is born and it starts talking, that'll be quite monstrous. Yeah. Because the word of the Lord tells us that under the Lord, everything has its time, it has its season. Now we have declared for the last 2 years it's been the new era, and you say that you're not in the new era. The baby hasn't even started walking yet, but know that the baby has been birthed. Yeah. I'm talking prophetic things now. The baby has been birthed. It has been recognized by prophetic and apostolic voices globally for the past 3 years. Who are you to say, no, it can't be a new era? You know what's going to happen? The baby will die in front of you. And I'm talking about your baby. Not the one, your one. Because you're not going to recognize it for what it is. You're not going to nurture it. You're not going to feed it. You're not going to take care of it. You're not going to allow it to develop the way it's supposed to develop. If you say, oh no, this can't be the new era. Fear blinds people to the new. And we'll do that because we won't know what it's going to look like. Some of us have got such control freaks, we want to have control over the prophetic things of the Lord. The Lord says it's a new era, you want to figure out what a new era is going to look like. You want to figure out what that means for you to be part of a new era movement. And if you can't see your place, you freak out. Why? Because there's fear in you. The Lord has never, ever, 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 ever said he's forgotten anyone. Never. But then you tell yourself that the Lord has forgotten you. Why? Because there's fear in your heart. And that's why I said the first part of that. Fear paralyzes your heart. Fear stops you in the track of momentum. Fear stops your advancement. Especially when you start looking around at other people. And we say, oh, but Lord, it looks like they're moving forward. Am I never going to move? What are you doing? You're allowing fear to grip your heart. And you're allowing fear to just paralyze your heart. And very often when fear paralyzes your heart, and by the way, when I say heart, I mean soul, you will find that your emotions are stunted to certain people. You will find that the thoughts you have about certain people are not the same. There might have been people around you that the ones you really loved and you valued and whatever, whatever. And if you crossed into a threshold of fear, where you allow fear to paralyze your heart for whatever reason, you will find that you become numb. That's what paralysis does. You will become numb even to the things of God. Jesus himself can walk in this room and you'll probably tell yourself, no, it's not real. Amen? Fear paralyzes your heart and you become numb to the things of God. You become numb to the voices of God. You become numb to the word of God. You become numb to the instruction of God. You find yourself moving more and more in disobedience. You find yourself moving more and more in rebellion because fear has paralyzed your heart. You will find that you reject, doesn't matter who's speaking. Somehow you'll just feel that now it's not for you. Somehow you just feel that, no, this is for someone else. Or, no, no, you've heard this before, whatever. Do you see how both of those are really drawing you from the new thing of God? Some people are so afraid of whatever, I don't know. There's so many things that people can be afraid of that they'd rather just sit and develop a little cocoon and stay in a little bubble because they believe that that's where they'll be safe. How are you going to advance in any way of your life, people of God, if you've allowed fear to paralyze your heart? And that includes when it comes to love, by the way. When I say love, I'm talking about relationships. Some of our hearts are still in the state of paralysis from things of the past. And we have carried that fear into the now. Which means we are carrying that fear into the new, which means that there are certain parts of who we're supposed to be becoming that has been paralyzed, it has been numbed. We need to ask the Lord to remove that fear from our hearts. We cannot move and we cannot advance in love and relationships when parts of us are half dead, when parts of us are numbed. Due to pain, we numbed due to our experiences, we numbed due to hurt. we numbed due to rejection. Amen. Stop holding on to the rejection, people. Stop holding on to rejection. It is paralyzing your heart. Rejection, in a nutshell, is afraid of being hurt or afraid of being treated like you were before. Amen. Oh, this is good. Number three, fear deprives us of unity. Fear deprives us of unity. I don't know, when the Lord gave me the song this morning, I sat a little bit, so I'm just going to start talking and see what comes out. Fear deprives us of unity. Remember that the Spirit moves when people are united. Going back a couple of weeks ago, even to Pastor Brad's message of the day of Pentecost, Jesus said to them, go, there was 120 odd in the upper room, and he said, go and wait for the power to come. They were in unity. They were in one heart. They were in one song. They were in one accord. And the Spirit of the Lord descended upon them. But fear breaks the flow of unity. Because if you're in a state of fear, it means that you moved out of a state of love. If you moved out of a state of love, it means that you moved away from the purpose and the intention of Jesus. And it means that you've rather moved into a state where you have allowed your eye and your heart and your mind to wander onto, once again, the imaginations. Once again, onto paralysis. If we're all in this room right now, and we're all calling out, and we're calling out, and we're calling out for the Lord to do something amazing, and one person is so afraid of what that could be that they don't pray. Can you imagine that? Or one person is so afraid of what it will look like. It will interrupt the unity of the house. Once again, I've sadly seen it too many times in ministry. You know, different people's movements. The Lord is moving, the Lord is pushing, the Lord is advancing people. And all of a sudden, one or two or three or four people decide, no, this is too much. The unity of the entire thing gets affected. Amen. The unity of what the Lord is trying to do gets affected because a couple of people have now decided, no, I'm not holding hands here anymore. Okay. Give me, let's have three volunteers. I need strong people for this, please. I just saw this in the spirit. Quick, three strong people. Thank you. Just hold hands. Come, quickly. Hey, just hold hands. Tight. Just face that way. That way. Even you go that way. I want the line that way. Right, that way. Okay. I'm going to attempt to break that thing. Okay, I'm going to run at full speed. I didn't say that. Yeah, Sarah, see, teach, please. I don't really know. Right, are you ready? Not the game, read over. We call upon man. Is there going to be teamwork? Not at all. We were watching this new thing last night. It's an Australian show. Pastor Al's eye was just caught by it. And it's about a baby. It's a woman that had a baby. I don't actually know the storyline of this, but anyway. So the father of the child travels a lot. And he doesn't really have a relationship with the baby. And he came back and the child was crying. Then the mom's desperately trying to get some sleep, she's like, and he's like, hey, the child's crying. And then she looks at him and she says, well, then tend to him. So then he goes to the baby and he says, what must I do? And then the mom says, pick her up. You know him up. And then he picks her up and he says, you won't stop, stop crying. And the mom is just like, you know, oh my gosh, whatever. But that's what happens when there's no unity. You know, even the rearing of something special, even the rearing of something precious like a child will be affected if there is no understanding, if there's no oneness. Amen. The Lord showed me, and I remember I spoke about it several times last year. If something has two heads, is it normal? It's monstrous. Okay? And the same goes for anything where there's supposed to be unity, or anything where there's supposed to be a oneness of voice. Anything with two heads. I say yes, you say no. That's a monster. Have you ever seen a two-headed snake? I'm not afraid of snakes, but I'm afraid of a two-headed snake. It's monstrous. Okay, it's not supposed to be that way. And that is why when there is fear, you create a little monster. Because when there is fear, you create a two-headed creature. Because when there is fear, unity is removed. Case number three. Fear deprives us of unity, and that is from the house, that is from the nation. Think about South Africa. From a couple to the nation, right? Think about South Africa. We're gripped by fear. Are we united at this stage? Not at all. Because there's fear in the land. There's fear. Think about America. There's fear in the land. People are shooting at each other. All sorts of weird things are happening. There's fear in the land. What happens when there's fear? People start looking for that enemy. People start looking for that monster. What happened in 95? You know, new country, Mandela's there, Rugby World Cup, United. No enemy. Nobody was worried about any enemy. Am I right? Those old enough to remember? I'm right. We were one, we were happy, everything. Now there's enemies in every corner. Now we must be afraid. Now this one is coming. Now they're going to take that. Now they're not going to do that. Now we've got NHI. Now we've got, and now everyone's just afraid. If these same things had happened, just think about this. Let's take NHI. If NHI had happened in 1995, people would have been, yes, let's bring it. We only need equal health care. Oh, yes, one nation, rainbow nation. But now it's 2018, 2019. Fear. Amen. Fear deprives us of unity, number four. Ooh, this one, I wrote this down and the anointing just dropped. So powerful. This one actually links to number three. Fear is a thief of like-mindedness. Fear is a thief of like-mindedness. Fear is a thief of like-mindedness. Fear is a thief. Like-mindedness, what is that? We're different people, right? We're all individuals. We all have our own unique gifts, our own unique purpose. But ultimately, we need the body of Christ. We need to have one mind. We need to have one agenda. We need to have one direction, if you're going. But when we are afraid, and you find people, okay, no, you carry on there, I'll get you there. You know, it's very South African, if you think about it. You know? We're all going there, we're going, I should let you get it. I'll get you there. I'll get you there, Mary. But you know, we've got this. No, it's fine. I'll watch on live. Don't worry. I'll catch you on live stream. Oof. The Lord knows my. Now, this is a love-hate relationship. It's not a love-fear relationship. My love-hate relationship with live stream. Live stream is I love you, but I hate the system. I hate that we can't be together. Or better still, I hate that you choose not to be together with us. Amen. So fear is a thief of like-mindedness. I'm afraid, last week, that message, oh my gosh, and my daughter, I'm afraid to go today. What if they call me out again and they prophesy over me? What if, you see, this is the first one on the right, the imaginations. And then you are deprived of that, the unity, the like-mindedness. We need to think together, we're going, that like-mindedness is removed. So fear is a thief of like-mindedness. Once again, this applies to couples. I hope you were listening. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Fear is a thief of like-mindedness in your relationships. But I believe we must invest the money. No, I believe we must spend the money. No, I believe we must discipline this way. No, I believe we must discipline that way. Are you trying to tell me I don't know how to discipline? I didn't say that. Why are you so afraid of? Amen. Fear is a thief of like-mindedness. Pastor and I often do a lot of trips. We did one on Friday, it was awesome. We just was an unknown. We go into a place we've never been to before. We didn't know what we were going to find or whatever. So obviously you get to that point where you know the map says this, but in the map also gives you two choices. Now, one of two things can happen. You can both agree on the route that you're going to take, and you can both hate the route, or you can both agree on the route that you need to take, or you can both, and then you love the route, and you're like, okay, cool. So, the route that I chose, that I suggested, was one minute shorter than the second route. Great. We're driving. After an hour and a half or so, we realized there's no toilets on the street. No toilets. We've had our morning coffee. Bladders are full, bursting to the whatever, whatever. But the bottom line is we both agreed that this is the route. We both were in one mind about that this was the route. Could the one shout at the other one? You could, but we chose not to. Amen. And isn't that what happens? That's what happens when you're in relationships. Somehow, because you're afraid of the outcome, or you're afraid of what the other person is going to think about you, that you run to blame quickly. But why did you choose this job? Did you not check that there's no toilets on the road? I didn't check that there's no toilets on the road. Living in one year, there's supposed to be toilets everywhere. Apparently, except that road. My goodness. Do you want me to stop when you make a phone? No, don't stop. I'll hold it. Stop talking. Because your bladder's so full. You think that every breath you take is going to force dives. You'll never be there. Bottom line is, we were like-minded, we knew, okay, now this was our challenge, what was the next step? Our next step was to look for the bottom. So, you search, you find the bottom, should we go here, should we go there? Okay, let's go there. Unity. That's a team. And that is why even in the teams in this house, I expect the same thing. It's not something that has been put on us by human beings, but it's how the spirit operates. And when there's no unity, when there's no like-mindedness, once again, you create a monster. I'm saying this about transport, you say that about transport. That's a monster. It needs to be cut off. Amen. So fear is a thief of like-mindedness, number five. Oh, this one was so good. Fear makes us function in the flesh. Fear makes us function in the flesh. You feel a prophetic word. You feel a tongue's word bubbling. You feel you've got something to say. But then what if? What are people going to say? What if it doesn't sound right? What if it's not right? What if it's weird? Then you're functioning in the flesh. Somebody came to me a couple of weeks ago. They said they had an interpretation of a tongue's message, and the exact words that the person said to me was, I was afraid because of fleshiness. Fear makes us move out of that place of the spirit into a place of the flesh. And what does that mean? It means that then we are moving in our own understanding. If the Lord says to you, go take the mic, release this prophetic word, go take the mic, release this tongues word, or release this interpretation, take the mic, release the song of the Lord that I put on your heart this morning, and then you sit there because you're afraid. Oh Lord, I'm afraid. I don't have a good voice. Did the Lord say you must have a good voice? The Lord said release the song. Yo, people of God, we need to stop rationalizing to the point of disobedience. We need to stop rationalizing to the point of disobedience. It's no use sending me a message 3 o'clock on a Sunday afternoon telling me, oh, I saw in the spirit that people are struggling with knee don't. Because if you do not have respect enough for the anointing and for the presence of God to respond in obedience in the moment, don't come and tell me and don't give me a look to me for a reason to forgive your disobedience. Amen. So now you're telling me, oh, I felt that and blah, 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 blah. What now? The problem has already come and gone. You should have spoken then and saved a whole lot of us. You got the gift. I don't have that gift. Amen. But fear makes us function in the flesh. I think about Moose a couple of years ago, when she's still operating more in the flesh than in the spirit. Thank the Lord, it's the other way around in our lives, especially in the worship ministry. And the one time, I don't know if Apostle called you up to sing or what, this, and I remember your face. You were just like, is this really happening? How dare this woman call me up to come and sing or whatever. And then you started singing, and then she pushed, she physically came behind, and she, and like, you know, because your face is dying on, and I was just like. But anyway, she did it. But now, if that is happening, I was like, yeah, I'm not doing that thing. So the more we engage with the Holy Spirit, the more the Spirit will expose who we really are. And we are not creatures of fear. We are not creatures. I told you, shyness is not a fruit of the Spirit. Amen. Shyness is not a fruit of the Spirit. It doesn't say love, joy, peace, shyness. Amen. We need to start thinking, where do these things actually come from, Lord? Because if Jesus says, Jesus has given us a ministry, to an active ministry which we all have, by the way. Going, teaching, discipling, praying, worshiping, fasting. He says, those are all active things. There's no space for shyness. But shyness comes from a place of fear. And fear will keep us in a space of the flesh. Amen. Remember, we're spirit beings having a natural experience. Number six. Oh, so good. Fear robs you of purpose and sight. Please put me over on the mic. I'm always straining my voice. Fear robs you of purpose and sight. Fear robs you of purpose and sight. Sometimes we can be so afraid of the unknown that we allow that to cloud our vision. We are so focused in what we think is a deficit of the now. We are so focused in what we think is a shortcoming or what is a lack of the now that we cannot look up and see what the real plan is. Fear robs us of sight. And when I say sight, I mean spiritual sight. I mean vision. I mean the ability to see beyond. Imagine, Moses' mother. Yoshibel, am I right? No, I'm right. Yoshibel, Moses' mother, Yoshibel. Imagine Yoshibel, she knew there were prophecies of a deliverer that would come to Egypt. There were prophecies of a deliverer that would set the people free. The people were praying for 400 years. Talk about patience. 400 years they waited in hard bondage, bitter bondage, slaves to the Egyptians, being beaten, worked every day, given nothing, not even a day's rest. And the people were praying, and the people talk about a longevity of prayer, right? Talk about long suffering. 400 years they were in there. Well, maybe not the full 400, but they definitely became that. And then all of a sudden there was prophecies of a deliverer that would come. And at the same time that people believe that now is the hour of deliverance, the Pharaoh sends out an edict that all the firstborn must be killed. Imagine if Moses' mother had lived in a state of fear. She would not have put their child upon the water. Amen. If Moses' mother moved in fear, she would have panicked, she would have freaked out, she would have tried to leave the place of him stay and probably be caught anyway and have the child killed. She did not move from a place of fear, she moved from a place of vision. The vision to get a basket, will take away our creative connection with the Lord. Fear will take away our sight with the Lord. Yes, Lord, I thought this was going to happen right now. I thought you were going to give me this, but that's fine. I'm not losing sight of the words that have been spoken. That's why I love when I watch these souls of videos. I can watch them over and over, because often they speak about the words that have been given to you. And many, many times we go to these conferences where we have words released into us, and then we forget them. Or worse still, because we don't see them coming true immediately, we start getting afraid. And we start panicking. We start getting depressed. If the Lord said that you are going to be an evangelist, you will be an evangelist. The Lord didn't give a time frame. So don't lose sight. I get very sad when people say, oh no, well the Lord said this and the Lord said that and it hasn't come to pass yet. What did I say in Nexus on Wednesday night? 1,000 years is to a thousand years for the Lord. In the Lord, time is very, very different than the way we see it. We spoke about what happens when you move from a place of fear. You get Ishma. You get a problem because you are losing sight of what the Lord has said. And that's what fear causes you to do. And it robs you of your purpose. A couple of years ago in one of the churches, a couple of people were ordained as pastors. And one person wasn't ordained as a pastor. Less than, I don't know, it wasn't even long. A year later or something, the person left. Left. Felt that God had forgotten me. Felt that God was only focusing on other people. Why do we lose sight so quickly when we allow a spirit of fear to enter? Because the spirit of fear will bring with it jealousy. The spirit of fear will bring with it competitive eyesight. A spirit of fear will bring us anxiety. It's like if the Lord says, to Abraham, like he said to Abraham, you're going to be the father of many nations. And Abraham rooted himself and he looked at Sarah and he began to panic. Panic is a symptom of fear. And because he allowed himself to move in fear, he went and he created Ishmael. And like I told the people at Nexus the other day, still to this day we see the chaos between the two sides. Because fear made him panic. And panic made him lose sight of the purpose. And panic made him lose sight. Period. Fear robs you of purpose and of sight. The last point. Fear needs deliverance. Fear needs, or rather, let me rephrase, we need to be delivered of fear. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a soundness of mind. So where did this come from? If you want to add a point number 8, if you want to, you can add that fear brings with it other things. Fear is a doorway. How many of you have done that healing seminar with Pastor Dave? I was supposed to have done it recently. My time just didn't work out. She does this healing seminar. It's fascinating. She talks about major doorways, doorways of choice, and minor doorways, doorways of generations. And fear is a major doorway. Fear is a doorway that is opened by choice. For one funny reason, and the minute you open that door, it brings you a plethora of other funny things. Like I mentioned, jealousy, panic, depression, anxiety, anger, emotional problems, mental problems, health problems. Now people have got pains. Now people are struggling. Now people have got stomach problems, ulcers, all of that. Ultimately, because a fear doorway was opened. Amen. Amen, people of God. So we need to see this thing for what it actually is. We're 40 days away from going to conference. For those of us who have committed enough to go. 40 days away from where? 40 days away from allowing the Lord to prepare us to remove a lot of junk. You You know, you can't bring new things into a house if there's still a lot of old things in that house. You can't put new vegetables into a fridge where the other vegetables are rotting. Amen? You can't put new, fresh things, things of life, things of purpose, into an old, rotting drawer and not expect a cross-contamination. And that is what I believe the Lord is saying to us. That's why when Pastor Al mentioned 40 days, I actually realized it in the week. I think the Spirit spoke to me and said 40 days. 40 days is a period of preparation. Jesus was taken out into the desert before his ministry began for 40 days where he had to really connect with the Spirit like never before. And yes, in that time there was temptation. Mark my words, over the next 40 days there's going to come temptation. Over the next 40 days there's going to come challenges. Over the next 40 days, it's going to feel like the devil is throwing the kitchen sink at you tough. Don't worry about that. Don't pay attention to an attention seeker. Don't pay attention, Evodia, to an attention seeker. You keep your eyes on the Lord. Don't allow fear. If your money things are not working out as they're supposed to, don't worry about it. Prophesy good things. 2 weeks ago, I had a message. I said, the Lord wants us to prophesy good things.
Words might seem to be dormant. Now is the moment that the Lord is saying, I'm calling forth
I want you to run quickly because I'm closing and I'm stop prophesying after that. If you want deliverance from fear, Pastor, I need you on the keyboard, please. I need apostolic sounds right now. Come on. Come on. We got our relationships are being affected. Our homes are being affected. Our ministry's been affected. Our purpose has been affected because we are allowing the spirit of fear to take dominance over Holy Spirit. We are allowing the spirit of fear to take precedence into our lives over the word of the Lord. We are allowing things that have not even happened yet. Things of fear, things of panic and of fear. Pastor, I need you on the keyboard. I need apostolic sounds. Lift your hands. Lift your hands. Lift your hands and say, yes, Lord. Yes, for my deliverance. Yes, 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 yes. Yes, you are. Allow me to reboot. see a whole lot of writings. You've got 9 o'clock this, 10 o'clock this, and this is your excuse as to why you cannot participate in the kingdom. The Lord shaved me a hand with a giant rubber. Erasing your schedule. Erasing your schedule. Erasing your imagined business. There's someone on live stream that is watching right now. The Lord is saying, stop with your imagined business. Stop imagining and coming up with reasons why you cannot be more integrated into your heavenly purpose. If you're watching on live stream, I see the tears. Just reach out. Reach out and touch the Lord. And allow the Lord to erase that schedule. We're in a new era. Schedules don't matter. Don't hold on to things that you knew from the past. Don't hold on to things that you thought crippled you before. Those things are still crippling you now. Allow the Lord to bring freedom from that fear.
Growth will come from one.